Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Art of Startup Fundraising, pitching investors, negotiating the deal, and everything else entrepreneurs need to know. By Alejandro Cremades. Foreword by Barbara Corcoran. Narrated by Jonathan Yen.
Foreword. My mom always said it was never a good time to have a baby, and she had 10. Whenever she told my dad, "Okay, Eddie, I'm pregnant," he would run right out and buy another bed. When I started the Corcoran Group, I grew the company the way my mom did her family. We grew from 6 to 60 salespeople in our first 5 years, and from 60 to 1,000 salespeople over the next 20 years. Because I knew the secret to growing a business fast is to never wait until you're ready. Every great entrepreneur I know expands long before their business is ready. It's the only formula I know for aggressive growth. It forces you to think faster and move smarter because you're always overextended and you have to pay the rent. With growth, many times additional funding is required to support the operations. I sit in a privileged seat as a shark investor on the Emmy-winning reality show Shark Tank, and each season we hear hundreds of heartfelt pitches from passionate entrepreneurs who are looking for funding. We listen to pitches for everything from the ingenious to the ridiculous, and get to put our own hard-earned money behind the concepts we believe will be big winners. Once a deal is closed, the fun part begins when I get to work one-on-one with the entrepreneur with whom I'm investing. I shepherd them from dream to execution, past all the hurdles and hard times, and if we're all a little bit lucky, on to a genuine breakout success. However, before I put my time, my money, and my partner's money behind any entrepreneur, I want to know everything I can about them and make sure every business I choose is a real winner. Investing in startups is a very risky business. Most of them fail. Some eventually prosper, but only a few make a 20-to-1 jackpot return. First, I'm looking for an entrepreneur with street smarts. Most of the entrepreneurs I've met don't have street smarts, and too many of them have answers that are way too smooth for me to trust. I'm trying to single out the winners with good gut reactions who are also smart enough to trust those reactions. I'm looking for entrepreneurs who can size up people quickly and motivate them, and spot opportunities where others see only obstacles. This takes not the usual book smarts, but real, live street smarts. I want to invest in the risk takers. Every great entrepreneur I've succeeded with has an unusually high tolerance for uncertainty. In fact, they're turned on by risk. Too many would-be entrepreneurs have buttoned-up business plans with lots of numbers, fancy projections, and reasonable deductions. Those aren't the ones for me. I want to put my money on entrepreneurs who know how to get back up fast after they've been kicked in the gut. They get knocked down just like us, but unlike most of us, they take very little time feeling sorry for themselves. I sometimes think to be a great entrepreneur, you need to have a low enough IQ so once you're knocked down, you're too stupid to lay low, and instead pop back up saying, "Hit me again." I don't think you can learn resilience. It's a built-in attitude. To me, this is what can make or break a pitch. The best entrepreneurs have faced challenges and risen above them. That resilience is what I'm looking for when I hear new ideas on the show and in life. I need to invest in founders who know how to communicate. I've learned that a new business goes nowhere if it doesn't have a good salesman at the helm. Somebody's got to sell the new product or service, and that's the job of the founder. At the end of every interview, I find myself asking, would I buy from this guy? Is his sales pitch irresistible? Based on the answer to that one question, I turn down 95% of the businesses that are presented to me. I've learned that the number one rule in sales is that everybody wants what everybody wants, and nobody wants what nobody wants. When you tell someone they can't have something, they always want it more. But let that same person know there's plenty to go around, and they'll always go home to think about it. If you don't have people clamoring for your venture, you've got to dream up a way to create the illusion that there is demand. This is why salesmanship is key in fundraising. Good salesmanship is never anything more than emphasizing the positives and playing down the negatives. And if you can find a unique gimmick, you'll have a huge leg up when raising capital, and also over your competition while you are executing on your vision. I first learned the power of using a good gimmick as a young waitress in a New Jersey diner, trying to compete with Gloria, a blonde bombshell with attention-grabbing breasts. Following my mom's advice, I tied red ribbons to my blonde pigtails to look like the innocent virgin I was. My tips immediately doubled. When I started my real estate brokerage company, the Corcoran Group, I used lots of gimmicks to build my brand. I'm always looking for someone who's a bit arrogant, as I've learned that aggressive entrepreneurs bring home the bacon. They make lousy employees, have issues with authority, and don't want to be told what to do. I like to put my money in the hands of an entrepreneur who thinks he or she knows more than me. They'll need that kind of confidence to jump over the huge obstacles that stand between them and the finish line. What I like best about angel investing is that I get to use everything I've already learned on Shark Tank. How do you impress an angel? How do you win their confidence and get their investment? There are tons of new business ideas out there, good, bad, and crazy. And I've seen my fair share of them all. The difference between a good idea and one that makes money is simple. It's gotta make sense. The idea can either be a totally new invention lots of people will use, or a much better way of doing something that's been done 100 times before. Another key ingredient that I look for when investing in a new company is work ethic. Before I invest in any business, I'm looking for a partner. A fancy website may get me in the door, but if you can't woo an angel, you won't woo your customers and build a huge success. This book by Alejandro Cremades will help entrepreneurs in obtaining a clear understanding of how fundraising works and what it takes to be successful in the process in order to impress people who invest in the startup ecosystem, like myself. Alejandro's experience as the founder of OneVest makes this book unique, as the fundraising game has been changing substantially over the past years with the implementation of new laws that were introduced with the Jobs Act. With the capital moving into the online world very quickly, this book should be a must-read for any entrepreneur who is beginning to raise capital to build their venture. Barbara Corcoran, investor on ABC's Shark Tank, founder of the Corcoran Group. Chapter 1. Everything started with OneVest. With the encouragement of my parents, Bernardo Cremades and Leticia Roman, I moved to the United States from Spain with my brother, Bernardo, on August 13, 2008, after obtaining my law degree in Spain. My brother is without a doubt my very best friend. On that day, after picking up our luggage and getting into a taxi, we were both completely wowed as we gazed through the windows on our way to Manhattan from the airport, while the driver, Luigi, told us his life story in a thick Italian accent. Initially, the plan was for me to earn my master's in international business and trade law at Fordham Law School and then practice law as an attorney. I had a great time at Fordham, even though some of my classmates were old enough to be my parents. They all called me Junior. 3 months before my graduation from Fordham, I received a great offer from the respected law firm King & Spalding. The partner who hired me was Edward Kehoe. Our first meeting was over breakfast at the Metropolitan Club. Ed is now a good friend, and he attended my wedding. I still remember my first day at the firm. It was like a Hollywood movie. At only 23 years old, I had my own secretary and my name on the entrance to my own office. It was completely surreal. After 3 years at King & Spalding, representing major corporations in high-profile, billion-dollar investment arbitration cases, I discovered my true calling. It all started when I attended my first New York Tech meetup with my good friend Luis José Skull. At the time, Luis was working for a hedge fund and sourcing tech startups as investors. One thing really surprised me as I immersed myself in the New York tech scene, and that was how difficult it was for entrepreneurs to access capital. When I researched cases like Pandora, rejected over 300 times before securing their first significant round of financing, I knew there was a big gap in the market. There was something missing, and I wanted to find out what it was and fill that gap. At the time of this discovery phase, I was dating the woman who is now my wife, Tanya Priva. Choosing her as my life partner is the best decision I have ever made. We talked about what I wanted to do to help others looking for capital, and I convinced her to invest all our savings in OneVest and launch a platform that would connect entrepreneurs with investors. And from that point on, the rest was history. Everything started at Tanya's apartment on 27th Street and 6th Avenue in New York City. We had a little studio where we would invite at least 5 interns a day to join us in building the product, and they worked with a team of engineers that we had assembled in Belarus, Eastern Europe. After 4 months of interns claiming they were our cousins, the building management figured out that something was up and invited us to leave. We then rented an office space, raised a seed round, and started to hire top talent. After 1 year of development, we were able to launch the platform to the public on November 23, 2011. A few months later, the platform was mentioned by Time as one of the best crowdfunding platforms in the world. It was listed as one of the top 10 digital tools for entrepreneurs by Forbes, and we were named one of the hottest startups to watch by Business Insider. I also had the honor of being ranked number 1 on Vanity Fair's list of 30 Under 30 for 2014, and I was included on the Top 30 Under 30 list in Entrepreneur magazine, Spanish version. The press attention was crazy to me, but what kept me moving was the opportunity to make a real difference. Cutting the noise is one of the hardest things that entrepreneurs have to master in order to focus on what really counts, which is the execution of business strategy. In the early days, it was not easy. We had to fight to provide financing. The Jobs Act, which we will discuss later on in this book, was still not in the picture, and the word crowdfunding had not yet been coined. At one point in the process, we visited the White House and testified before the U.S. House of Representatives regarding the importance of financing small businesses in the United States. Everything started to happen at the same time. To our surprise, we were suddenly riding an amazing wave, forming with the passing of the Jobs Act in April of 2012. For the first time in history, startups would be allowed to advertise the fact that they were raising money. Before the Jobs Act, this kind of promotion was completely forbidden. Prior to that legislation, it was labeled as general solicitation. Previously, the search for funds was more a word-of-mouth kind of activity. If you did not know anyone in Silicon Valley, it was a real struggle to find capital. At the end of 2013, a company called CoFoundersLab.com came to raise financing on OneVest and lit up a light bulb in my mind. I realized that a fundraising platform like the one that OneVest was operating at that moment was really playing a small game. The bigger game was to build an ecosystem around OneVest where we would empower entrepreneurs and investors from formation to financing. As a result of that realization, the conversations began with Shahab Kaviani, the co-founder of CoFoundersLab.com, and we ended up announcing an M&A transaction to bring CoFounders Lab under OneVest in July 2014. Currently, CoFounders Lab is the largest matchmaking service for entrepreneurs. It's a way for entrepreneurs to meet their co-founders and advisors. We are partners with some of the major startup hubs in America, and we are onboarding thousands of entrepreneur registrations on a monthly basis. Other products under the umbrella of OneVest include, most recently, 1000 Angels, which is the first digital invitation-only network for a select group of angel investors. It is a curated community of ultra-high-net-worth individuals that come together to invest in startup companies. After seeing hundreds of businesses formed and financed through the ecosystem of OneVest, I felt it was time to share what I'd learned and help entrepreneurs on their journeys in fundraising, especially after our most recent round of financing, in which we'd increased our total amount raised to over $5 million. We self-crowdfunded our Series A in a matter of weeks and established a record. I literally did not move from my desk. The result was a huge surprise, as these types of rounds would have normally meant spending at least 8 months out of the office, attending conferences and meetings to gather investor interest. Unfortunately, the company announcements of successfully closed rounds of financing that you see and hear about are not the reality. They come from only a few companies out of the many, many ventures that launch each year. Raising capital is an art. Every single ingredient needs to be perfectly balanced in the process in order to secure capital successfully. This book aims to be the guide that will help you get there in a process that, many times, can be a roller coaster ride full of emotions. Fasten your seatbelt and embrace the process. Be optimistic and have fun with it. Remember, you will never fail. You will either succeed or learn. Chapter 2: Raising Capital for Your Startup. Before rushing into preparing pitching materials, meeting investors, and hammering out funding terms, it is critical to get your mindset, expectations, math, and strategy right. Speeding up the machine. Some opportunists and entrepreneurs see the promise of funding or financing as the chance to get someone else to put money on the line to build their dream into reality, especially when it is a product or tool that can only be brought to life with major money. Space exploration and revolutionary healthcare progress are great examples of this. But these types of fundraising missions represent big risks for investors. And if you've tried walking into a bank for a startup loan, you already know that it's going to be a challenge. There is another way to approach raising capital for your startup. It's meant to speed up the machine, not build it. This can really present the best opportunity for both fundraisers and funders. By building the product first, entrepreneurs establish that ownership, control, and lead. They also have the opportunity to build and hone a business model that works regardless of additional funds. That's a much more powerful fundraising and negotiating position to be in. On the other side of the table, investors are able to put their money to work with confidence in a startup that has a product and one which is proven to work. More money just helps to speed up the achievement of various milestones and to magnify the successes and strengths. When you are raising money from outsiders, there will be expectations to deliver certain types of milestones in a given timeline. For that reason, it not only helps to have a product on the market with some historical data when negotiating your financing terms, it also helps to avoid a significant dilution that comes with raising money as you're working to figure things out, assembling the machine. Most startups eventually pivot to adjust to what the market is telling them. I have yet to see a bulletproof business plan, so it's important to have proof of concept and validation before taking the risk of bringing outsiders into the mix. Take a moment to think and re-clarify why you are raising capital. Consider what it will do for you and what the opportunity offers to potential investors. It's not as easy as reading an article on TechCrunch. If people read the weekly headlines on TechCrunch or various startup and fundraising blogs, it sounds as if anyone who can fog up a mirror can land several seven-figure-plus rounds of funding. Some people have the impression that if you throw up a crowdfunding page, you can land $1 million to play with as you like. This is one of the biggest pitfalls facing startups today. It's not that easy, at least not for most startups. The truth is that it takes work. It takes effort, time, and an investment in thinking and taking the small actions that can create big results. Aside from the right mindset and expectations, successful fundraising takes making connections, marketing, and proving yourself and the product. It takes strategically rolling out and executing a plan. Often, that requires help. According to data from Forbes and the SBA, Small Business Administration, venture capitalists fund only about 2% of the opportunities they review. While not all new businesses need or seek funding, consider that there are around 600,000 new business entities that file each year. In the first quarter of 2012, only 3% of venture capital, VC, funds went to brand new startups, while 97% went to ventures that were already running. This information is not to discourage you from your startup or from raising capital, but rather it is meant to better prepare you for what you need to do to effectively and efficiently score the capital you want. While it's important to build the product first, whenever possible, and prove the concept, you can choose to create a starter version, or MVP, minimum viable product, or provide other proof of testing and demand. Define what makes you convinced that this venture is a go and that it is a good opportunity for investors. The 18 to 24-month plan. The savviest founders give themselves plenty of time and cushion to raise the capital they are aiming for, and 18 to 24 months is a good time frame. Don't worry. This doesn't mean putting everything else on pause or slowing down your startup. In fact, continuing to clock progress in development, branding, your client base, and sales can help in the fundraising process. Perhaps you already have a business plan and have even started selling or building great relationships and establishing distribution channels. That's fantastic. But you will need to meld your business plan and your fundraising plan together if they aren't already a part of the same document. Perhaps you initially thought you wouldn't need outside funding, but now you see the advantages, or you thought you could land a bank loan, but it didn't happen, or you are just now realizing that raising substantial amounts of capital in the best way is going to take a little longer than you think. Just take the time to recalibrate and ensure synergy as you progress. Whatever your number is, break it down by funding rounds and by business milestones. Divide your needs into easily actionable steps that will take you where you want to go in the next 18 to 24 months. Milestones. Notable milestones to be achieved during your startup and fundraising process include idea conceptualization, market research, business plan creation, testing the waters, finding your co-founders, making key hires, building a board, prototypes and beta testing, launch of a minimum viable product, expanding early adopters and users, gaining revenues, proof of demand and potential for scale, break-even point. Entrepreneurs should be focused on raising the capital to make it to the next milestone and round of funding. This amount should include a cushion for overages and a budget for marketing for more funds. Work toward each milestone and give it the proper attention, even if you have the long goal of an IPO, buyout, or putting a legacy business on autopilot. Breaking even. While there are many milestones in the process of launching, nurturing, and growing a startup, the break-even point cannot be overlooked. Let's be honest. Until the break-even point is reached, all income is burned cash. And that even applies when the numbers are in the tens of billions of dollars. But once the break-even point is reached, startup founders can then negotiate from a place of power, and they technically don't need another outside dollar. However, additional funding can certainly help. That money can be funneled into real growth and maximized. It is important to note that many of the biggest companies and those that have attracted major investment still haven't achieved the break-even point. It isn't a prerequisite for raising capital. Peter Thiel tackles this issue in his book, 0 to 1. He reminds us that the real value of a company and how savvy investors view opportunities is the future value of cash flow. If you aren't breaking even today, when will you be? How much future cash flow can investors buy into? What discount are they getting by buying into that cash flow now? Expectations of investors. What are the expectations of investors? Unless startups know what investors expect and are looking for, it's hard to give the right signals, prepare and position your company to be the recipient of funding. So what do investors really want? In asking this question, it's often easiest to first address what they don't want, which is to lose money, to be made to look foolish. Everything else, including expectations, circles back to avoiding these two pain points. Some expectations may be arrived at naturally and individually. Many others are line items that investors believe they need to check off. But they all come back to avoiding these pain points. Here is a list of the 19 items that investors want and expect. 1. A well-thought-out and researched business idea and plan. 2. Organization. 3. Integrity and character. 4. Answers to obvious questions. 5. That you know what you don't know and don't have, but have a plan to get it. 6. Market potential. 7. Plans for repayment if seeking a loan. 8. Plans for additional rounds of funding and or exits. 9. That you have put your heart into the project. 10. That you have and will keep skin in the game. 11. Feedback from others. 12. Proof of demand. 13. That they can get along with you. 14. That you are coachable. 15. Consideration of the safety of their capital and time. 16. A good match. 17. Passion for your product or service. 18. Passion for connecting with and working with them. 19. An opportunity that will take them closer to their goals. while pitching and engaging in other fundraising efforts, and even in the activities leading up to those efforts, entrepreneurs must keep in mind that they are not selling their product. They are selling an investment in their company. This shouldn't mean completely redesigning the venture and sacrificing the original vision simply to raise funding, although some do go through the process when it becomes apparent that it is needed. Still, if founders work to know their investors as they do their customers, they'll find the fundraising process easier. Understanding investors' fears and pain points, their checkboxes, and their goals. This doesn't just mean cold monetary goals. Go well beyond promised ROI and crude sales and cash flow predictions. Institutional and individual investors have metrics and numbers that they are trying to hit. What else drives investors to invest? Outdoing their competition, bragging rights, strategic navigating, the desire for security, and a drive to fulfill their potential fuels and facilitates solutions that they care about. These are the constants. Then there are the factors that are more spontaneous and heat of the moment. Does a decision maker need to impress or please someone else in the chain by making an investment? Can a Shark Tank scenario be created that fuels competition between investors? As much as we each believe otherwise, when we launch a venture, a startup is far from a sure thing. Without capital and connections and expertise that can influence markets' future performance, a startup is often a string of optimistically strung together dots and assumptions. Refer to the checklists in this chapter often to give yourself an advantage. Outperform the competition. One of the best ways to attract capital is to outperform the competition. This will certainly help in your pitches, presentations, and discussions, all while boosting results and your negotiating strength. And it might just help you get noticed and draw attention, minimizing the work and investment involved in chasing money. There are different measures of outperforming. Can you outperform in profit margin, sales, social media, startup battles, or growth? How about outperforming on fundraising? Peter Thiel points out that Twitter is a great example of this. While Twitter might have a lot of work to do, it has shown great growth versus a declining print news industry. Outperforming in growth means people believe in future potential and indicates there is a time to get in while there is still a perceived discount available. So, find your edge and define a metric that you can outperform on. If you are not already outperforming on one of these metrics or need to create more distance ahead of the competition, pick your strong suit and lean in. Don't unnaturally force something that will derail the venture or sabotage your fundraising potential. Look for an edge you can hone and maximize. So, how do you gain traction or visibility in this area when you are already going all out? 8 methods are recommended. 1. Prioritize and focus attention on that area. 2. Get help. 3. Get up earlier. 4. Compete in competitions. 5. Participate in development or coding marathons. 6. Attend conferences. 7. Go to networking sessions. 8. Join invitation-only communities of like-minded people. Marketing. The majority of startups have to market themselves to have any hope of getting funding. They have to market hard and outmarket hundreds of thousands of competing startups and existing businesses. Do not underestimate the time and money investment required for marketing, both ongoing and fundraising-specific marketing. All marketing speaks to potential investors. It tells them a story about the value and potential of your company and what you are really about. Done right, your regular marketing can go a long way in helping to position your startup to attract and convert investors, especially angel investors. If initial marketing and branding is done with fundraising in mind, results can be maximized and your budget can go further. So look for crossover potential and review messaging with fundraising in mind. Your initial marketing may include branding materials, websites, and other online assets, apps, rounds of testing, sponsorships, product placement, social media, in-person networking, and more. Don't burn out on marketing. Don't burn up your marketing budget and bankrupt your startup and fundraising mission right before you see results. Plan to need to market longer than you think until you secure funding and see your cash replenished. Don't take the excitement or early investor advantage out. Make sure messaging has seamless synergy with your pitch deck messaging and your presentation. Ask, is this going to appeal to, turn on, and compel our target investors to write a check on the spot? Or will it send them running and telling their investor friends to stay away? Note that investors will be more interested in organic growth. This means building channels that give you traffic without having to invest capital in order to acquire users. This could mean crushing it on search engines or a serious viral loop on your product that keeps bringing people in the door. Venture capital firms are enthusiastic about social networking effect. They go crazy when they see the entrepreneur has figured out how to crack that code. Storytelling. Storytelling is a critical part of marketing for startups. It's a critical part of marketing, branding, building consumer loyalty, and growth for fledgling startups and the largest international corporations alike. For startups, it can be the make-or-break part of the pitch. It also has a place in the elevator pitch, pitch deck, verbal branding, visual branding, website content, and perhaps even in your tagline. Businesses that have blossomed through storytelling include Tom's, Patagonia, and the Dollar Shave Club. Every brand and venture has a story. Even if you don't realize it, you have a story. And it is what has led you to where you are today. Everyone has a unique story, and different brands leverage different parts of their stories to reach their goals. Zappos' story was all about company culture. Airbnb's has largely been about the sharing economy movement. Apple's is about Steve Jobs. Fast-growing nonprofit Acumen has done an incredible job of incorporating masses of supporters in its story with books, interactive classes, volunteer chapters, and Google Plus community groups. Ultimately, the best entrepreneurs are not the best visionaries. The greatest entrepreneurs are incredible salespeople. They know how to tell an amazing story that will convince talent and investors to join in on the journey. Many entrepreneurs unfortunately overlook the value and importance of storytelling and focus on technical info, which investors and consumers simply can't relate to.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.